Good morning and welcome to Coastlands Online Church Service. It's good to be with you today and we hope you're all well and we hope you have a really, really great time with us today. So this morning, Phil is going to be speaking to us about provision, God's provision. And it made me think this morning and I just thought it would be a really wonderful thing to share. Is that I work for the food bank, for the Vale Food Bank, and when the pandemic hit in March 2020, I was just like, oh my goodness, what are we going to do? You know, I just thought there's going to be so many people in need, and how on earth are we going to provide food for all these people? You know, you're just thinking people aren't going to be going shopping, supermarkets aren't going to be able to donate what they normally would, all this. And well, it was nothing of the sort. God provided in the most amazing, miraculous ways you could possibly think, and it overwhelmed me. It was just incredible how much God provided. The need was there, but God provided for that need. And he continually does, you know, working within the food bank. And see, you know, we completely rely on donations, and there has not been a moment where we haven't been able to feed our community through the food bank. And we are just, and I know absolutely that is completely God's provision. So I just thought that was a really appropriate thing to share this morning, as we're going to be hearing more about God's provision, what it says about it in the Bible, and how he really does provide for us in our lives. So let's worship our provider this morning through our first worship song together.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In the questions, your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You will carry me safe to shore. Sure, safe to shore,
with sorrows. There is beauty in our tears.
Good morning. I want to share God's word with you today, a word which has been incredibly profound and prophetic to my life. It is a word that God gave me back in 2017. And this was a time where I felt God was changing me as a Christian. I felt that he was revealing himself to me as a God of love and grace, as opposed to the God that I always thought he was, is that he is a God of love and grace, but he can also be a God who sometimes I looked at as a judge and was harsh. And although God is a judge, and although God does bring judgment, I never really grasped God's amazing grace and love. And this was a time in my life where God was opening my eyes to the power of the cross, his love which sent him to the cross to die for our sins, to save us, and how much he loves us and why he did it. And it was transforming my Christian walk. And my prayer life was great. I remember having such intense and intimate times with the Lord, not because I had to, but because I loved him. And he was really doing a change of through his Holy Spirit in my life. And so one morning in this time, in 2017, I felt God speak to me profoundly. And I want to share that with you today. One morning I was praying and I was walking somewhere praying, and I felt like God say to me, "Phil, read 1 Kings 17. And I thought, "Oh, is that God? That's a very out of the blue word to come into my head." And I didn't know what to do about it. I prayed for a little bit, and then in my time of prayer, I kind of forgot about word, read that 1 Kings 17, and decided to go for a walk and carry on praying. And it had gone out of my mind. And so I went down the island for a walk, and as before I did, I went to the petrol station to fill my car up. And as I did, I noticed two blackbirds, ravens, I thought they were, come close to me at the petrol tank. And I thought, "Oh, that's strange." Didn't think too much of it. Got in my car, drove down to the island. And on my way, I kept noticing ravens. I know they're everywhere, but I had a particular drawing to ravens. I thought, "This is strange." So as I was praying down the island, I was having an immense time with the Lord. I felt his presence on me. I felt him speaking to me. I just felt an overwhelming love for God. And as I was worshiping him and listening to worship music, I came to the point down the island where there's a big white cross. And I stood there praying at the bottom of this cross, and I noticed two ravens on the left and the right arm of the cross. At this point, I said, "Lord, are you saying something to me about ravens? And if so, what are you saying to me?" Nothing came. I carried on walking, and I got to a point where I was tired in my walk, and I sat down on a bench to pray, to pray and read. So I got my Bible out, started reading it, and the voice came to me, "Read 1 Kings 17. So I opened up my Bible, found 1 Kings 17, not really knowing what was in it. I couldn't remember. I knew that it was about a guy called Elijah, but I didn't know what was specifically in 1 Kings 17. As I read this, I was blown away. 1 Kings 17 says, "Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah, 'Leave here, turn eastward and hide in the Kereth ravine, east of the Jordan, and you will drink from the brook, and I have ordered ravens to feed you there.' So he did what the Lord had told him, and he went to the Kereth ravine and east of the Jordan and stayed there. The ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook." I want to tell you this, is that as I read that, the hairs on the back of my neck stood up. This was a moment where God was speaking to me. We all feel times where, "Oh, I think God is speaking to me," and they're great. And they're moments where we really feel like, "Oh, God is directing me." But there's times in our life where God is speaking to you, and it's like, "Whoa, God is talking to me right now." And I felt him talk to me. And so I said, "God, what are you saying? What's this message about ravens? What's this message about..." You know, in verse 1 to 2, which I hadn't read but prior to this, the context was that there was going to be a dryness come over the land, that there wasn't going to be any rain across Israel in Elijah's day. And Elijah had prophesied that no rain will come over this land except God's word. And for 3 years, there was no rain. And then I've just been reading, and I've been thinking about ravens, feeling like God's talking to me about ravens. And then I read in 1 Kings 17, after this voice told me to read it, saying, "Go to this river, I'm going to send two ravens, and they're going to take care of you, they're going to bring you food." So I said, "God, what does this mean? Is this for me? Is this for the church? Is this for everyone? What's this message?" And through prayer and seeking God, over time, God has unfolded and revealed to me different aspects at different stages of this message. And my understanding, not a complete one, but is this. Is that I wrote it down. I felt like the Lord was saying that a tough time, this is in 2017, a tough time is coming upon the earth. A dryness, a time where the economy will take a hit and also people's faith will be shaken. And instead of putting on the hero cape, I'm asking you to wait. because I am doing a new thing, and in this time, I promise to preserve and provide for those who trust in me. I will send two ravens to supernaturally preserve and provide for those who trust in me. 3 years later, a pandemic hit the earth, which has shaken our faith in many ways, left many people with questions. The economy has taken a hit, health is still taking a massive hit, and there's still a lot of uncertainty. And in a time where the church is needed to put on the hero cape and fly to the rescue and bring revival to the land, it has been found at times frustrating for churches to be the voice and to be the river of the Holy Spirit that this world desperately, desperately needs in its dryness. And that's not to say churches haven't done great things throughout the pandemic. They have, and we've learned so much in this time. But it has in many ways been a frustrating time, a time where we haven't felt let loose to bring revival power to a desperate and dark, lost situation. So what is God saying? What is he doing? You know, in all these COVID rules and regulations and all this frustration that the church has had to go through, what is God saying to us? Well, I believe that God has a word for us today. I believe that God wants to bring revival to his people, an outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon his church in the coming time ahead. And when that will be is up to God, not up to me or anyone else, but the Holy Spirit. But I believe that God wants to pour out his Holy Spirit across a lost generation, across a lost world. And the word I have is, do not be afraid. As I've said before, I am doing a new thing. It's not difficult for me to repeat this new thing phrase that I've been preaching recently. And you might have heard me preach on the new thing, but I feel that the word still needs to come to us to remind us that God is saying in these days now and in the days that are coming ahead, don't be afraid, I'm doing a new thing. I believe God is preparing his church for what is to come. And what I believe is to come is what Elijah experienced in the Bible, following on from when the ravens fed him in the dry desert, in the drought, where there was no rain on the land for 3 years and many died of starvation. After those 3 years, in 1 Kings 18, God told Elijah to go and pray that rain would fall on the land again. And Elijah did. And when he first prayed, there was just a small little cloud in the distance, just as big as a fist. And he could see the rain coming, but yet nothing came, but he prayed again, and still it grew larger. And seven times he prayed. And by the seventh time, the rain burst upon the dryness of this land. And I believe that's symbolic and prophetic for the rain to fall on the land of Wales again, where God is putting his church into a time of preparation, where they fall on their knees and cry out for the rain. And the rain will be the tears of our eyes. The rain will be the hunger and the passion to see God's glory restored in our land, in our communities, in people's homes, in the church, where God reigns, where the kingdom of God advances and pushes back the kingdom of darkness. Amen. Do you want that, church? I want that. That's what I'm passionate for. And I'm believing in 2022 and 23 that God is going to continue to reveal things to us. But we are in a time of preparation. And we mustn't wish or push or try to hurry the time of preparation away. It is good for preparation to take its proper toll on us. If we don't have preparation, our hearts are not prepared for what the Holy Spirit wants to bring. I believe that God wants to bring us to our knees to pray again. I believe the land of Wales is a land of praying people, where people prayed in 1904 and God did great things. But I believe that God wants to do something greater than 1904. But it always starts with people desperate and hungry and praying for God to move again. And that is the call. Don't be afraid of what's going on. I'm doing a new thing. I am preparing and I am drawing you to a place where prayer brings about the rain. And this is what God is saying, is that I will do this and I'm doing this, but I want my people to trust me. You might feel in a dry time right now in your life, but God is asking you and me to trust him with what he's doing. Don't hurry him, don't rush him. God's timing is God's timing. He knows what he's doing. It could be around the corner or it could be down the line. Only God knows. But he is releasing a word to say that if we trust in him, he will do this. Trust in what? Trust that no matter what we go through, no matter how dry or difficult it gets, they say the darkest hour is just before the dawn. Well, sometimes it seems so dark and bleak after God has given us a word. He's like, where's the promise, Lord? Well, sometimes it gets really tough. And God is saying, do you still trust me? Do you believe that I will come through? I want to ask you this morning, and I ask myself, do we believe that? That no matter how hard it gets in our life, no matter how difficult we find ourselves in, God promises that if we trust in him, he will see us through. He said it to Elijah, as I've read to you this morning, that Elijah, is going to get tough. There's not going to be any rain. It's going to seem dry all around you and resources are going to be few. But do you trust me, Elijah? Do you trust that I will provide for you? Morning and night, I will send ravens to bring you your food. Now imagine that. Imagine that. Ravens. Birds who are scavengers, who take the food for themselves and not give it to anyone else. But God has commanded them to drop off this food supernaturally to keep him alive. Friends, if you're going through a tough time and you are desperate for a word from God, God can bring you his word in the most supernatural ways. Nothing is too hard for God. Nothing. But what he's after is your trust and your belief in his provision. He's never changed. We change. But God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he promises to give you everything that you need in Christ Jesus. He just asks for our faith and our trust in that. God told Elijah that I will see you through. And I believe that God is saying to you and I today that in your difficult season, in this dryness that's upon your life, maybe as an individual or just as a holistic thing that's going on in the nation, God will see you through. Are you going through a time where you feel a sense of hopelessness? Are you going through a time where you feel, this is tough, man. This is hard. I can't get through this. I don't know how to. I'm self-medicating. I'm in despair. My mental health is all over the place. I feel anxious. I feel worried. Where is God in all of this? Well, I believe that you need to, and I need to, stop trying to figure everything out for a start. Because trust doesn't ask us to try and figure everything out. One of the most famous Bible verses for me is Proverbs 3 verse 5. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart and don't lean on your own understanding, but in all of your ways acknowledge him and he will make your path straight. Trust in the faithfulness of God. Don't try and work out your problem. Don't try and figure everything out. It'll exhaust you. But just say, God, we're in this situation. I'm in this situation for a reason, and I trust that you are good and you are going to bring good through this. You see, the devil is after your faith. He's not after anything else. He's not after your good works. He wants to rob you of your faith, your trust that God is good, even when things seem dry. If you do that, if you trust in him, God promises the greater days are coming. He will make a pathway for you where it doesn't seem like there's a pathway. You might say, Phil, my situation is impossible. Well, I say, God is the God of the impossible. God sent these two ravens to Elijah to keep him alive, to provide for him. It just goes to show how nothing is too hard for God. You might be feeling dry right now. You might be feeling that, oh, I've sinned in such a way that I feel cut off or shut off from God. I haven't read my Bible or prayed properly or all of this stuff. But I want to say that God hasn't forgotten about you. God hasn't given up on you. In your dryness, God is interested in whether you will still trust him to see you through. God has not forgotten his church. God has not forgotten you and me. God loves his church, and he has promised that the gates of hell will not destroy his church. And God's church will rise again in victorious power, revival power. I believe that. We just need to get a revelation of who God is once again in our lives. We need to get a revelation of how powerful the gospel is and how God has set us free. We need to allow God to prepare our hearts for this move and this revelation that he's doing. It's hard to wait though, isn't it? And I imagine at times Elijah had to wait. You know, he's being fed, he's being kept alive, but still, when am I going to get out of this dryness? I'm still in this dryness. When am I going to get out of it? I can relate to this in my own small way. I'm waiting to move home, and at times it felt like a slog. And it felt like, God, when are we actually going to, move into the house that we've been longing to move into, but it's just taken so long. And in this time, God is teaching me and Becky so much about waiting and trusting and not stressing. But we can wait, we can stress. God will give us a promise and it feels like we have to wait for it. But in the waiting, God is doing so many great things. And I want to say that you might feel like you're having to wait for a word of God over your life. Just like Elijah, having to wait there. God's feeding me, he's keeping me, but still, I'm not where I want to be. God promises that if you trust in him, he will get you there. But in the waiting, he is changing you. In the waiting, he is breaking you. In the waiting, he is molding and shaping your character. He's showing you things in your life which is not helpful for you. And he's asking you to lay it down. In the waiting, he's doing more work than what you realize. He did the same to Abraham in the Bible. Abraham was given a great promise that he'd be a father of many nations. And then all of a sudden, he had to wait years for that to be fulfilled. And why was God doing that? Because God is always, always, always in the business of teaching us to trust and have faith. These are the key elements. The Bible says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. And God called Abraham the father of faith. And he wants you and I to have faith today. No matter what the devil's doing, no matter what our flesh has done, no matter how bad things are in society, God is asking us to wait on him, to trust in him. The Bible says, those who wait on the Lord, he shall renew their strength. He will give them, we will soar on wings like eagles. But it's in the waiting, God is doing the preparing. Don't rush away the waiting, because that's where God is doing his greatest work. Some of you may have been worrying recently. Maybe God's finished with me, or asking yourself, I can't even trust anymore. Feeling purposeless, feeling discouraged, finding it hard to read the word or pray. Reach out today with me and take God's hand called trust. Say, get alone with him. Find a place where you can pray. Go for a walk and just say, Lord, I've been going through a season where I felt stuck, hopeless, dry, wondering if you're going to get me out. But today, God, I'm going to choose faith. I'm going to choose to trust in you, O Lord. I'm going to choose to resign myself into your care. You know, one of the greatest things I've read in the Bible is when I read about Jesus saying on the cross, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Jesus understood something about resigning himself completely into the will of the Father. And God's will and plan and purpose for your life is good. But God wants you to hand over your worries, your unbelief, your mistrust, and say, God, into your hands I resign my life. Do whatever may come, do what you will. Oh, that's a beautiful place to be. And I want to encourage you today to get alone with God and do that. No matter what's going on in the nation or in your life, resign yourself into his God and say, God, today I'm choosing to trust you. I'm choosing faith. I'm choosing joy. I'm choosing not to listen to the voice of the enemy. I'm choosing to move forward because you are a God who have never broken your promises. Amen. Pray with me. Father, today we just thank you that no matter what is happening, no matter what is going to happen, we know this, that if we trust in you, you will see us through. God, you will provide for us supernaturally. You will keep us. We won't burn out. We won't wear out. Lord, you're a God who is faithful. What you're after, we know, is our faith and trust. So Lord, will you teach us to trust you and have faith in this season ahead so that we just see with faith that cloud, that rain in the distance growing and growing. Bring us to our knees, Lord, where we pray pray with passion for you to pour out your Holy Spirit. Let it rain, God, on our land once again. Let it rain on our church. Let it rain on our lives. Lord, we just pray for your Holy Spirit to move in us for your glory. We pray that you would help us to wait in the preparing of your work, the preparation of your work over our lives. Teach us, God, to be patient, but also full of faith that that day is coming, where that cloud is growing, where the rain will be poured out once again. In Jesus' name, amen. Be blessed. God bless.
Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it rain. Sing out, let it
shores rejoice, clouds and thick darkness surround him. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne. Fire goes before him and consumes his foes on every side. His lightning lights up the world. The earth sees and trembles. The mountains melt like wax before the Lord. Before the Lord of all the earth, the heavens proclaim his righteousness, and all peoples will see his glory. Oh, we want to see your glory, God. Oh, God, we want to see your glory. You want to see his glory? Lift your voices. Lift your hands. We want to see your glory, God. Oh, send down your power. Oh, God, send your glory. We want to see you move in our generations, oh, God. Move, God. Come and move amongst us. We want to see your power. We
Thank you for being with us this morning. Pray and hope that God has touched your heart or spoken to you in some way this morning. And please do get in touch with us if you are in need of anything. If you would just like somebody to pray with you, please do get in touch, and we would love to have that opportunity to do that with you. So have a really good and blessed week, and we're here if you need us. Take care and God bless.